Hello. Are you recording now? So, hello. My name is Vicente Guallart. It's the first time that we are ever connected doing a presentation in real time through internet. So it's 3 p.m. quite sharp. And as it happens always, is that the previous presentation were quite late. So we will start like in 10 minutes. We'll start around 10 minutes. So if there is anyone down there in internet, I ask you to wait for 10 minutes. Students did incredible work. We'll be presenting some models and some other stuff. So we'll start, okay, let's be very sharp. We'll start 3:15 sharp, okay? See you, thank you.
Thank you. China with the constraint of China. So this is not a model.
This is a model.
Hello. Hello, everyone. Yes, thank you. Again, my name is Vicente Guallart. I am architect. I am talking here for the people in Barcelona, but also to the people in internet. So as I say, I am IaaC founder. I was chief architect of the city of Barcelona. I am back here at IaaC and in other places doing some research. So the experiment that we start with the new program we launched, the Master in City and Technology, is try to bring to the limit the ideas that we had about the self-sufficient city. We try to demonstrate that this is not a new trend, that this is something related with sustainability, is something about trying to demonstrate that in the cities we can develop a new urban model. So the traditional model is the centralized one. We could talk about the decentralized, but what we want to develop is the system for the information age, the distributed model. I don't know where here. Okay. Centralized, decentralized, distribute. So this is, could be the traditional centralized model. Remembering the words of Ramon Folk, when you make a city that is so centralized and so big, the system doesn't work at all. And this is what happened also with the biology with cells. So the question is how you can develop as a model, not destroying all the city, obviously, but doing something else. So in Barcelona, we start to work on this idea of the decentralization. This is the map of the markets around the whole city. And another fundamental question is that in order to develop the project for a city, as a full self-sufficient city, we need to discover what are all the layers that we need to include in our puzzle. In order to talk about the layers in the same way that we talk about the human anatomy, if we talk about the urban anatomy, we can see all the different layers. So the experiment that we are doing with students is we decide with the new 9 students that will be presenting later from the new master in City and Technology, they have been working each of them in one layer in order to produce a project altogether. So this is something I learned when I was a student. The best class that I had in my life is not when I was working alone, but when the professor say, each of you are going to do something and all together will produce something bigger than each of your aspect. And this is something, this is what we did here. So the basic concept is that the model for this is in fact the idea of the 10 minutes walking city, the idea of a neighborhood is something like this. In 500 meters radius, you should include all the facilities that you need in order to live. This is what we have been trying to do in Barcelona in the last years. But the question here is not only about the public facilities like markets, schools, etc. Our idea is, and this is the question we were asking ourselves, are we able to produce all the energy that we need? Are we able to produce all the food that we need? Are we able to fabricate everything that we need? And then the answer will be given by the students and the research that they did. The other question is, instead to have a circle, what we decided was to take 1 square kilometer. That means that we can draw a circle here of 500 meters. And then what we decided was to put 25,000 people in 1 square kilometer, because this is the amount of people you need to have around 1 market in the Barcelona model. Also for schools, for libraries, everything, to have density is fundamental. And the question again is 25,000 people is a high density. Barcelona is 16,000 people per square kilometers. And today the standard in the world in general is lower because it seems that in order to be green, we need to have less density. But in fact, what we need is to have more density. So the research Rodrigo did in the past about the definition of the different 1 kilometer by 1 kilometer in order to see that there are different possibilities, and the decision that we took was to use, I don't know if we have here, to have a model that could be similar to the one in Taipei, where we have this kilometer by kilometer, and what we have is a kind of diversity of densities within these so-called super blocks. So the idea, in order to see that we are not crazy, we are not developing only 500 by 500 meters, the idea of the city that we are developing is something like this. It's a city where we have units of 500 by 500 meters that are the units where the bus are passing through. So all the, those main streets that are 50 meters wide are in order to have the bus, and this is the basic structure. And in fact, the kilometer by kilometer that we have been developing is something like this. It's four units that this is what generates this kilometer by kilometer. But the scale is not always the good scale for everything. And in order to talk with transportation, with the work that we develop in Barcelona, with some work done by Salvador Rueda, André Ulliel, and many other people. So the idea is that we should have a grid of every 500 meters to have bus stops that are moving in that and in that direction. And this could be one potential city, and we'll be working in the near future about how to define a city with 100 neighborhoods, so 2.5 million people. Our idea was to define something new from scratch in order not to have the question of the reality, the existing, and always talking about, oh, but the reality is different. Everyone say that in the next decades we'll be building many cities for hosting people that will come to cities, mostly in India, in Africa, some of them in China or whatever, but even more in the cities that will be accumulating more and more people. The idea that we really can see that in a neighborhood of 1 kilometer by 1 kilometer, we are able to produce what the students will say is something fundamental. So in order to discuss this, we invite as a juror, Roberto Pagnani. He's professor in the architect and professor from the Politecnico Torino. He has been doing similar projects like this. He's working in projects, European projects between European and Chinese city, and he has been doing projects of sustainable architecture and urban development. We have also, with us, will be coming soon, Artur Serra, that is an anthropologist. He was, in fact, the first co-director of the master program 15 years ago with me and Manuel Gausa. We have also, as guest, Guillem Camprodon. Guillem is expert in technologies, programming, electronics, and everything. So he's working in the micro, but here this will be the macro scale of the concept that he's developing. We have also with us Jonathan Minchin. He's the coordinator of the Baidaura laboratory. He's developing, we will be developing in the future, a full self-sufficient habitat. In that case will be maybe for, let's say, 30 people. Here will be like around 1,000 times more people than in Baidaura. But Baidaura is a good place to do such research. And then we have also Rodrigo, Rubio, Ruxandra, Alessio that are collaborating with the education, and Matilde and Jordi that will be also making comments. So the idea is that you have, each of you, like 10 minutes to make your presentation, and we'll have 10 minutes more to make questions and comments and everything. And then the result is that we want to be able to answer if we can grow all the food that we need in the city or not, if we want to drive without run a city without private cars, if we can produce all energy here, if we can manage the water, what would happen with housing or with the public space. So this is what you are going to answer us. So Ruxandra, can you please ask the students, and Areti, Marco Pulu, that can just join us.
First, Matilde, do you want to say anything? No? No, not at all. Okay, so who starts? I think Myra. Sorry, I will stop the music first. Okay, good afternoon to everyone. Today we will be presenting our research about the self-sufficient neighborhood prototype. First, I want to talk about why we have to be self-sufficient. And when we start seeing this the CO2 emissions, the movement and its distribution, it's evident that we have to do something about the global warming. And cities contribute 70% of the world. And this is why we have to concentrate as architects and urbanists in the responsibility of making these conditions better. Okay, so as we were seeing before, we have different city models. The centralized model, it's a city that has grown around the city center. We have also decentralized models, which are more like a sprawl city, you could say. And also the distributed city, which, as Vicente mentioned before, is the one that we are working on and the model we want to follow. We see here these cities, for example, these two, Atlanta and Barcelona, have very similar population, but the transport carbon emission changed dramatically, mainly because this model of city causes the higher rate of use of automobiles. And of course, fossil fuel, if you can see, 7.5 different from 0.7. And so we know that the city must work as a network of cells that must be self-sufficient in themselves to make a tissue or a self-sufficient organism. And okay, as we were seeing before, this is the model of our city. We were half a network of these self-sufficient cells that we work together, joined by different infrastructures and green corridors. Okay, so when we started our research, what we did was we started seeing about the different layers that work on the city. So we start by nature, then the physical realm, let's say, which is the buildings, the energy, the mobility, water, matter, information. These are always present in the city, but sometimes we don't see because all these systems are connected to a bigger system outside our cities that sometimes are not present directly in what we see every day. But I want to present some problems that in the worldwide scale are inherent to the problems. So in our city, we want clean energy because we know that the burning of fossil fuels to generate electricity is causing a lot of here, and we want our neighborhood to have all production of clean energy. We also want to ban private cars inside our city because, as you can see, we have problems around the world with mobility and traffic jams and also the pollution caused by the cars. We also want local food because we want to reduce the distance between the production and the consumption, and also because this would help these biggest infrastructures outside the city to become smaller. Then we have intelligent management of water because we want our city to be zero waste in terms of water. We want to treat all the water and help with this world problem of water consumption, because right now we have a gap between supply and demand, and if we can help with this inside our neighborhood, we would improve the global conditions. Then, as you know, also waste is a huge problem right now because there are a lot of countries that consume a lot, but then they export their waste to other countries that then have to put it in landfills or process it. So we want zero waste in our neighborhood. And this also leads us to diversity. We want the, our city to be diverse in terms of uses, in terms of, we don't want like concentrations of only housing, because mixed use allows us to reduce the mandatory movement of people outside the cells of the city. So this is the first layer, urban planning, and this is where the rest of the systems will act upon. So as Vicente mentioned before, we have 1 kilometer by 1 kilometer and 25,000 population. And this is the distance is because it's an easily walkable distance for a person. And the population is because this is the radio of influence of a lot of important facilities that we will have inside our neighborhood. So when we started thinking about this, how we would act in this void, let's say, we started looking at some of the different urban fabrics, and we concentrated on compact and dense cities, but also we wanted to see those that would that behave as hyperblocks with the similar similar dimensions to what we have, and to learn a bit about like their DNA and how we could import these characteristics to our own neighborhood. So at the end, we chose Abu Dhabi, two examples in Barcelona, L'Eixample and Gràcia, Islamabad, Melbourne, and Taipei. So as you can see, these cities are in different parts of the world, in different, very different conditions, with also different areas and population. But for example, we chose Abu Dhabi because we were interested in this series of high-rises in the border of the hyperblock. And for example, Taipei also has this series of high-rise and mixed-height buildings, also mixed uses inside of it. In Barcelona, we were interested in the composition of the grid in L'Eixample. And in Gràcia, we were very interested in the tight urban fabric and how it works as a pedestrian city. Then in Islamabad, we were interested in how this green corridor interacted with the cells. And then at the end in Melbourne, we have a mixed use neighborhood, but we were also interested in this the categorization of the roads and the dimension of the blocks. So at the end, we have different series of morphological parameters that we were analyzing, like floor area radio, dwelling density, open space, average block area, population density, and coverage. And after seeing this, we would start to see how we could act in our project. So we have this 1 kilometer by 1 kilometer, which becomes our boundary roads. And then we have two other crossing roads every 500 meters. This defines the center of the neighborhood. And we have 200 other roads here. And then the ending block is this one that would be transversed by pedestrian roads also. And we have this green element right here and a series of corridors that would be green and metabolic. And then we decided that in the corners we would have more height also at the borders of each block. But when we talk about cities, we cannot only refer to the morphological elements, because it's true that this impacts directly on how a city behaves and also its citizens. But we also wanted to start looking at the metabolic parameters and also the physiology of the city and how this makes the city more sustainable. So in terms of metabolism, we have the different layers. We have the information, the food, matter, energy, water, and transformation. And we did an analysis of two of the cities that we had chosen before, Melbourne and Barcelona, and saw how these different layers behaved inside these two cities. And we could see that, depending on that, we decided on what we wanted for our neighborhood. And yeah, it depends on, like, for example, in the water. We have the waste, the water consumed by capita, as well as for energy. We have different parameters that would determine how much more sustainable or not the city is. And then when those parameters are, let's say, taken into account, the city can also be sustainable in terms of physiology, which is what makes you like live properly. So we have resilience, contingency, diversity, and habitability, which gives us a series of characteristics that the city should have to be in terms of sustainability. And these are our main goals in the neighborhood in terms of each of the layers that my partners would now present to you. And now we will talk about food. Thank you.
Hello, my name is Shireen. I'm going to talk to you about the layer of food. So as you can see, the agricultural footprint is a very important one in our planet. And actually, if we combine all of the agricultural lands that we use, we will get the size of South America. And this is if we exclude the land of grazing for animal agriculture. And in parallel, we have also a growing population that passed from 2 billion to 7 billion people in less than 90 years, and it's still increasing and is expected to reach 9 billion people by 2050. And so we will have to provide global food production and increase it by 70% until then. And another fact is that 1.3 billion tons of the food that we produce, which is approximately one third of it, goes to waste. The water consumption in the agriculture layer is of 70% of our fresh water. And concerning air pollution, 48% comes from precisely animal agriculture. And so we decided that we were going to analyze different diets and try to find out which one will be the most efficient one. Concerning meat for meat consumers, the amount of area that, well, first I talked about how inefficient and polluting animal agriculture is, but other than that, we will have to, if we want to produce locally, we will have to raise a lot of animals for 25,000 people and occupy an important amount of area in the prototype, which is not very productive for us. And so we try to look up vegetarians. For vegetarians, we replace animal meat by dairy products. And the dairy products also come from animals. And so we will have the problem of importing the food again. And our goal is to actually produce everything locally. And so by being vegetarians, our 25,000 people will have to import 35% of the food, which also would not work for us. And so we turn to vegans. Vegans is a very different diet. It's more sensitive, and so we have to measure it by the amount of calcium, protein, iron, and vitamin D. And those will come from cereal plants and trees. Well, I know when you hear about 25,000 people, vegans, it's a bit unrealistic, but when you hear about those facts, such as if every American dropped one serving of chicken per week from their diet, it would save the same amount of CO2 emissions as taking 500,000 cars off the road. And so it's it logically goes towards efficiency when we reduce, when we take out meat and products such as dairy products. Other than that, of course, it will reduce the amount of water. And also, there's the fact that raising animal is really inefficient because we give much more than we get. For instance, we will use 16 pounds of grains in order to produce 1 pound of meat, which is really not efficient. So the next step was to analyze the different types of fruits and vegetables according to the amount of protein, calcium, iron, in order to be sure that we will be able to provide the nutrients for the 25,000 people. And other parameters were analyzed, such as if they grow on trees or not, if they can grow in our weather. We took the weather of Barcelona in our prototype. The amount of water it consumes to make sure that it is efficient. And by analyzing all of that, we came to priority crops, which means that we will give those nutritious foods the most amount of land. After that, we also took into consideration the seasonality, because we will have indoor and outdoor farming. For the outdoor farming, we will grow there the foods that don't need that don't have the problem of climate, that can grow all year, and the other ones will be more controlled into the indoor farming. So these are the different types of agriculture that we want to implement in our system. There is first of all the permaculture, which is a natural one. It's actually the use of public lawns in order to be productive. We have greenhouse rooftops, which is efficient because we actually use the areas that are unoccupied, like rooftops. And we also have vertical farming, which is basically a stacking of greenhouses. We have green rooftops, a garden, where we will also have colonies of honeybees. The nut trees will grow into our streets because we think that it could be, first of all, it's very nice aesthetically, and second of all, we want to dedicate the other areas for the agriculture crops. LED farming is going to be implemented in a very small area, 5,000 square meters, because it's a type of farming that is still under testing, but we want to implement it because it's actually basically a technology for food center. So this is the distribution. So permaculture, we use the public lawns, as I said. We have the greenhouse rooftop. The greenhouse rooftop would be combined with the solar panels. We have the LED farming, the nut trees, and the vertical farming. About vitamin D, vitamin D is a problem in the vegan diet, so I had to address it specifically. I found that mushrooms is one of the main source of vitamin D, and we are going to grow them in a total area of 2,000 square meters, which is double the area that we need, in order to be able to provide enough vitamin D for our vegans. Mushroom agriculture does not need light, so we will put the mushrooms on the underground of the vertical farms. This is the process of mushroom farming. It needs a total of, it needs to prepare the compost, and then every 3 to 5 days we'll have a new production. As for honeybee apiary, they will grow, as I mentioned before, into our rooftops, and we will need units of 0.25 square meters, the amount of 1,428 colonies. So this is the production and distribution of food in our cities. From wheat, the problem of wheat is that if we want to grow it locally, we will need 3 to 4 times the land that we have. So the wheat will be imported. We then have the beans that will grow into vertical farms, greenhouse rooftop, and etc. We'll have vegetables that are also going to all grow locally. The nuts, we will grow 1% of the nut needs, and 4% will be imported. The fruits will also be distributed. There is a very, very small amount of fruits that will be imported, which are the tropical fruits that we cannot grow into the prototype. And these represent the mushrooms and the honey production, which is also local. So this is the total production distribution of food. It is a total of 90% of food production. Thank you.
You didn't introduce me.
Yeah, okay. The next layer is water. And for water, I started to have a look like water and in general, the natural resources, how they started to be a problem or issue for architecture and planning. And when we go back to 60s, this first photo of Earth from the space, this lonely photo in the black ink space, made people realize and society to fall into a shock that the world was not actually infinite, but finite. So we had to take care of this into our planning and architecture activities. But after 50, it's been 50 years that we realized this fact, but how have we have been treating our resources during that time? And this is the Catalonia River and Coastal Water Quality from the Water Agency of Catalonia. In the dark red areas, we see the bad quality waters. And we can see that in the end of this image. The main reason of this bad water quality is the inappropriate urban treatment. Because according to Catalan Water Agency, the water reuse and treatment is a common practice in Catalonia, but it is made in a way that after treating the water, we send it back to the river instead of using it direct to the point. So it makes these harm to nature. And the other problem for urban areas is the management of rainwater, because this is the list of disaster brought by rain during last century in only one continent of the world. So this is a really big problem as well. Before starting the numbers and our methodology about water, I want to mention our ultimate aim was to see the possibilities of 0% wastewater circle by a reuse of 100% of wastewater direct to the point that is necessary and managing 100% of rainfall. We started to see the water need of 25,000 people in different sectors first. Opposed to the normal urban systems, we are growing our food. So agriculture in urban area for us, the main demand for water, different to the other than the other systems. And then we also see the amounts for water of potable and non-potable demand for our washing machines and showers, etc. But how did we come to that numbers is actually this was the previous one was for annual numbers. And this is for taking account the seasons, because fruits are depending on agriculture types. If they're outdoor, they're they're affected by season. So some of the foods are not going a lot of months, but most of them are going to a lot of them because we make a vertical agriculture. And in the end, we come to this conclusion that the water demand of agriculture is not same for every month. So we have to have a intelligent management of water or treated water to the agriculture with a really good programming depending on seasons as well. And here we see the physical infrastructure of water. Every system about black water, gray water, about rainwater from roof, rainwater from streets have different kind of an infrastructure and different distribution. On the left side, we can see that, for instance, rainwater management from roofs requires a more local, even like for a small blocks, but the treatment centers need like a bigger scale than the rainwater treatment, depending on their efficiency of scale and also the maintenance and management. And how do our treatment plants work is explaining that black water after coming to plant is passing through different phases and then go to agricultural use. But after that, the waste of black water is also used to produce energy in the biogas plants, which is dehydrated sludge. How water harvesting systems work. These are, as I said, it's working in a smaller scale, working in a small apartment neighbors and small block. Therefore, they because they are more efficient and they require less energy to treat in that way, because they're not transported to anywhere, there's no leakage, and so we can use more efficiently. And but what can we do with this rainwater is that we can see here the washing machine water demand of 25,000 during the year for each month. And water in general, the water that comes from the hard surfaces can cover more than enough for the washing machine use. What's that? Are you open here? Oh. Yeah, and here we see the image which shows, yeah, we couldn't see, but anyway, which shows the main aim of us that takes water from resources and then reuse in different kind of flows and then having the zero waste water cycle. Thank you. Now we see the my friend Seda for the layer of energy.
Hello, I am going to explain you our self-sufficient energy strategies. First, I start our research with a comparison between urban model and energy consumption amounts. You can see direct energy consumption size is directly related with urban models, density, transportation, and industry. And then we focus on energy production methods, technologies, based on urban scale and capacity. And we did same research to energy storage technologies. Then we decide our self-sufficient neighborhood energy production and storage technologies. We use photovoltaic solar panels, transparent solar panels, biogas for generating electricity. We use thermal solar panels, and biogas is for heating. And when we analyze day by day, month by month, energy production numbers, we realize that we need two type of energy storage technology. One of them is short term, which is lithium batteries, and another one is long-term energy storage. Thermal bank is for heating, and hydrogen shell is for long-term electricity storage. It is a kind of guide to understand energy consumption in human scale. For example, we need 1.5 square meters solar panel for two people house. We need 8.5 solar panels for a shop. We need almost 16 square meter solar panels for a big data office. We need almost 20 square meter solar panels to generate enough energy for an electric bus in a year. We need 6.3 solar panels for rooftop energy in a year. We need 150 square meters solar panel for a wood fabrication center. And while my research, my inputs are changeable, so I have to be parametric. So I work with digital tools and a result of this processing, I made a Grasshopper plugin to calculate and visualize of energy production, consumption through day and year. And all my graphs that I am going to show you are generated in this plugin. Please download and help me to develop it. And this is yearly energy circle. As you see, as you know, solar energy is changeable. For example, we produce much more we need in summer, and we produce less than what we need in winter. So it is clear we have to store it. Long-term storage method is hydrogen batteries for electricity, and we use thermal bank for heating. This is a daily energy circle. For example, on 2nd June at 8 o'clock, we produce much more what we need. So we have to store it. The overproduction energy is transferred to hydrogen fuel for use it in winter. On 2nd December, we need much more energy supply. So we use hydrogen fuels. This is also we need much on 2nd June at night. We produce less than what we need, so we use short-term battery to supply our energy. And this is our yearly solar radiation map. The super blocks are shaped by sun path. And this is the axonometric is distribution of units. We use photovoltaic solar panels, which are most efficient way to produce energy by sun, are located where solar radiation is high. And we use transparent solar panels are combined with greenhouses. They are less efficient than photovoltaics, but we combine with greenhouses. So it is for food and energy. We use thermal solar panels to generate heating, hot water. And we have three kinds of energy storage system: hydrogen batteries, Li-ion batteries, and solar thermal batteries. And this is a total diagram how we generate energy, how it connects to energy type, electricity and heating, and how they distribute by sectors. This is a kind of guide to how to make self-sufficient energy. We generate 100% clear energy. We use our energy sources in the most efficient way. We store overproduction for short and long term, and we minimize our energy consumption. Thank you.
Hello. I will be explaining about the layer, about matters in the city. I want to show some basic slides in the beginning showing why studying of matter is one of the important important layers of the city. This is a world map showing the extraction and the consumption comparison between different continents, and as you can see, it's very important. The consumption and matter cycle is important to maintain a balance between the economic of the whole world. What is matter cycle? This was the basic study of Sankey, which we developed after studying of the matter cycle, which is currently present. It's about how different kind of materials come in the city. The distribution of the materials, then the waste, the distribution of waste, and then the final was about what happens at the end for the waste. So after studying this, what the conclusion was about how much does per person consume waste, and also different kind of waste in a year. When we saw the final stage was about how we will be adapting this layer of matter on matter cycle in our prototype. The cycle which we were following is very simple. It's about we not letting anything go out of the city, like no waste goes out, there is no waste, and also making in the city. So once we started researching, the more detail we were looking about matters and each objects, we did a study of lifespan of each objects, also daily, like hours of usage in one year. What we came up to after the, studying this graph which we made was what can be locally fabricated and what are the objects that can be shared. Like objects with longer lifespan but used for less hours in a year can be shared between the community, and the longer lasting objects can be locally produced. How can we make it? How can we fabricate it? The stages which we included were about making it in the neighborhood. A few of the policies were about designing a longer lasting product, also material recycling, products that can be easily repaired. In the waste, it's not about throwing away, it's about returning it back. So we were discussing about reusing of materials, so there is no landfills. And what can be achieved in this was zero waste, no landfills. 25% of the production needed can be done in the neighborhood, 40% recycled products, and out of the waste, 12.5% energy can be generated out of the whole energy required from waste. The waste generated when we were comparing to the other cities, the waste generated in our cities was, our prototype was by 25,000 people was this much, based on different household sizes, like one person generates this much and so as you go, and then the final number was per day almost 32 tons. The most important stage according to us was about collecting waste. So we start from the very basic level at everybody's houses. They have segregate the waste in different categories. Then the waste flows to each of the sorting centers and then to the facilities which is needed. So we have a material recovery facility, a biodigester which then goes to composting, and then the final product is compost. Also about how energy from biodigester it's converted to energy. From material recovery they have different facilities that it goes to. About the network, how it sets physically in the city is there is a part of fabrication and then there is a part of waste. So as you can see, these are different fabrication centers which we have located in the city. There is wood fabrication. So what we divided was it's not only about fabricating, but it's also the major aspect is also about repairing. So we have like a big facility for repairing the wooden furniture and also fabricating it and storage. It's, as you can see, it's based on the main roads where the trucks will generally go, which won't come anywhere inside. This is also food facility that we are providing. It's about there is a food facility near the market which is centrally placed, so the locally produced food can be collected and stored here, which can be then centrally placed and then distributed for each of the smaller markets or smaller commercial shops. There is also a bigger facility for food here because we have all the agricultural land and open space here. There are different kind of fabrication facilities, like for ceramics, for textile. Also, there are smaller fabrication hubs, which are more like the knowledge center, how we promote fabrication in the neighborhood. This is a facility where it's more about experimenting and also fabricating smaller objects for the neighborhood and by the community of neighborhood. There is a central bigger fabrication facility near in the center where it's more about awareness, where we can show people what we can fabricate and how we can use recycled products for fabrication. We have a logistic facility. Then the waste flow, how the waste is collection, like each collection centers, then material recovery center, where it's all sorted out. First the cardboards, the paper, then steel, aluminium, and then sent to the different facilities. If there are products that can be used, they are sent to each of the facilities needed. After biodigester, the output is generally biogas, fertilizer, and compost, that is solid waste. Then this is this goes into composting facilities, which is near the food center and also the open space agricultural land, which is here. This is the final physical layer of how everything sits in the city. So this is the current scenario of how can it be built. How can the city be built by matter? This is what we want to do. It's about the prototype produces around 22% of the things required. But when a few prototypes, a few neighborhoods like these come together, this much amount, 85% of the amount needed can be produced. Some things have to be imported. There will be also things which are in excess can be exported. And this is how the end product will be. It's about how much the distribution and from each layer, how much will go to each of these facilities and what will be the end result. So we have energy, compost, recycled products, fuel, recycled material, also reuse part. This is the final scenario, what we are trying to achieve. Like, this is the existing scenario, and this is what we want to do using a circular economy. Not only reduce the requirement, but there is no waste by using the waste. Yeah, thank you. After me, it's about housing. So, thank you.
Hi. Another important component that I'm going to explain in our neighborhood is housing. So as we started research about housing and different house sizes around the world, that we can see different countries have different home sizes in huge and a drastic scale. Like for example, in Hong Kong, the average new home size is 45 square meters, but in US, it's 201 square meters. And we had a similar condition with the average residential space per person around the world also. The Australia, it's 89 square meters per person, and the Hong Kong is again 15 square meters. But after finding these averages, it was important to also look at the standards and what could be the possible scenarios for our neighborhood. Then we focused on two standards. One is UK standards, and the other one is the United Nations Healthy Housing Guide. But we ended up using the UK standard, which is more recent and also more optimized and updated. So another research that we did was the different house sizes in Barcelona. So we picked six different house types, and each house type has like three different scales, one small, one medium, and one large. Then we can see also the range of different house sizes in Barcelona. And after the physical aspect, studying the physical aspect of the housing, it was important to ask the question, like, who's actually gonna live in these houses? So we looked at the different household structures around the world, and what's distribution of different households and what's the relation and the ratio to each other. At the end, we have a similar household structure closer to Barcelona and European Union. Self-sufficient neighborhood household structure has 11 components, and it's mostly a couple with children, singles, but also we have, as you can see, we have no single households. So that brings one of our most important strategy, which is shared housing. So no one is living alone in our neighborhood, but people actually share apartments. And after, with the standards we have with the housing sizes and the household structures, we started to match with different household types with house sizes. And then we ended up with the three different housing categories, which is the family housing, shared housing, and housing for tourist accommodation. And one of the important things we've done also was to devote some of the housing for couples to the for tourist accommodation as an Airbnb, which is an important concept in today's housing concept. So with the distribution of different house sizes and household types, we have a different scale of distribution in our neighborhood. And as you can see, we have like a large number of one-bedroom apartments, but also if we combine all the shared housing, we have a more shared housing than the one-bedroom and two-bedroom apartments. And the basic strategy for distribution was housing, was to have the shared, to locate the shared housing closer to the urban side and closer to public transportation, and do this family housings closer to the center, which is more pedestrian. And also put the tourist accommodation, of course, along the perimeter, which is more urban, and also the shared housing for older people are close to the green spaces, which will be also for easy for them to walk and walk out the city. And then we start to look at the adjacencies of different household types, because we don't want a segregation of certain household types in one building. We want the diversity of different houses. So you can see in different scenarios here, in a very small scale, like for example in this one, it was important to have a shared housing for people who are 65 and older in each block. So here you can see the single parent with three kids and the shared housing and the couples, etc. So in, even in a bigger scale, we have a similar condition here that all the different households are in the same block and in different types. Also on the more like urban side, the higher, where we have the higher blocks, we also have housing for students, a tourist accommodation, and the housing for people who are between 16 and 64. And the another important thing also to have a different typologies within the within our neighborhood. And the first one is a small block, which we have created small patios and courtyards to increase the level of interaction between different household types. So like the two different household types meet, share a courtyard. And also with these stepping and creating courtyards, we were able to receive more sunlight and access to the green rooftops, which are used for agriculture. And even the large blocks, this sort of typology creates trees, alleyways, and passageways between household types to add another layer to the city. And as we go, as the scale gets bigger, we have housing also on top of the offices, which have a higher level of privacy and sun exposure. And by creating these different types of modulation of housing, we also create another layer of public space on top of the offices. So it acts as like a threshold between the offices and the households. And also the hybrid distribution of residences and offices, because the building will be occupied evenly throughout the day, because the offices are here and the houses will be here, and the consumption of the energy will be consistent. So there are some possible scenarios in our neighborhood. Like for example, at this point, there's a 53 units with 250 people. And in this point, there's a 53 units also, and then with 332 people. And then this one, we have like 139 units with 781 people and with different households. So in our self-sufficient neighborhood for 25,000 people, we have 8,453 people and with the 8,004 square meters, and then the average household size is 3.0, which is higher than European average. It's 2.4 because we have shared housing. That's why the average household size is big. And then we also have the 32.2 residential space per person. And with all these numbers obtained by three basic strategies, which are shared housing, hybrid buildings, and mixed typologies. Thank you.
No. Back. Hi. I'm gonna talk about facilities. Okay, this is the evolution of facilities in Barcelona. Barcelona is our reference in this studio. So we can see that facilities in the last 40 years are have increased, starting from the almost 2,000 facility in the metropolitan area of Barcelona in 1975, and now in 2015 are almost 6,000 facilities. We can see the different steps in the evolution of facility from the centralized facility during the dictatorship to the decentralization of facility in the neighborhood. We can see that like the civic center are very typical in Barcelona, are the place of participation in Barcelona. In the 19 facility where the strategy was to locate facility in some centrality area, in some specific part of the city. Most of the big cultural facility were built in this in the 90s. And starting with the financial crisis in 2008 and the rising of technologies, information technologies, some facilities started to be replaced for services. And for the future, new paradigms are influencing the evolution of facility, like sharing time, sharing knowledge, or interchange of goods, of knowledge, or services. And we can see like this, where is this? Okay. These are the market that are transversal facilities, because are old facilities, but now are still working and are some representative facility of Barcelona. This is the proposal for facilities for our self-sufficient neighborhood, divided by category and by level. So we have basically four levels of distribution of facility. We have two facilities at city level, and most of the facilities are at neighborhood level. And in some cases, we have the same facility at neighborhood level and at hyperblock level. And the lower category is the facility, small facility at block level. Normally, facilities are defined by standards. This is the resume of the most important standard for our facilities. We will talk later about the area and the distance that are the most important standard for facilities. The distribution too, and the age group is important too, because some facility like primary school are for a specific age group, but other facilities like a health center or a library are for different age group. So we think that more mix is more public life, more opportunities. Some facility can be called e-facility, so can be improved in the distance, like some educative facility. And some facility are temporary, like a market can be temporary, like the night market in China. So we have to provide some spaces for this temporary activity. Facilities. These are the areas of the facilities in our neighborhood by type and by category. We have 21 types of facilities, and we can see that the educative facilities are the ones that occupy and require a big area, a sport facility and commercial and production facility too. This diagram represents the distance for each point of the neighborhood to reach each facilities, measured in meters or in minute walking. Basically, we have four types of influence area for facilities according to the level of each facility, the block level, the hyperblock, or the most of the facility are in the neighborhood level, and are divided in diary use or no diary use, because for diary use, we need a short distance to the facility. This is the strategy for distribution of facility according to the scale of the facilities. For city level facilities, for city level facility, they are is the university and the research medical center related to the hospital is in the corner, close to the perimeter roads, because serve all the city, not only our neighborhood. For the neighborhood facility, they are located basically in this diagonal line that join the city level facility and the main green area. And this is a very important point in our neighborhood because it's the civic center, the cross, the intersection between the two main roads. The hyperblock facility are located in the center of each hyperblock, and the block facility are in some in the ground floor of some blocks close to the pedestrian path. This is the distribution and plan of all the facility. Other two important criteria in distribution, the distribution of facility, is that they have to be linked to public space, to green spaces or no green spaces like squares in the city. We can see in this line that we have different size of the plot for facility according to the scale. This plan represents the use of the facility in plan. So we can see that we have some hybrid buildings with mixed facilities that are in the close to the main road and in this the line, diagonal line. And we can see that those are the area occupied for each category of facility, that with the university and the hospital, the education and health facility are very bigger, very important. In order to think how to mix the facility in buildings, we studied the relation between facilities. So the thicker line is not strong relation, and the bigger line as are for strong relation. These are the criteria. So if the facility are in the same category, they have a big strong relation. If the user are the same, in this case these two facilities are not in the same category, but the user are the same. Or if the facility have a complementary function, for example, for some father to have some training is difficult if they have kids. So if in the same building there's the sports center and the kids center, it will be easier. And the frequency of use. So if two facilities are for daily use, they are well connected. So this graph represents the same concept, but focused on each facility. So we can see that in the first two lines, there are educational and social facilities that are well connected than this facility, like security facility or administrative facilities. And this is the proposal for the five hybrid buildings that are located close to the main roads and in this diagonal. The most important is the market. And in the same building, there are the market and the fab lab with the idea of make and sell. And there are some civic facility like community center and the religious center with the because of the idea of the relation between food and religion. This is another important mix hybrid building for facility with the idea that sport means health and health long life. So we mix sports center, health center, and old age center. This is a cultural educative building with a library and some school like language school or whatever, and some facility for young people. So this is a possible section for the hybrid market. We can see that in the base there are the market, the fab lab, and the postal office that needs some logistics. And the civic religious facility are in the upper part with a new urban square. And this is the like a possible section for an hybrid sport center with the health center related to the sport equipment. And this is the old age center. I have to introduce public spaces after me.
Hello, today I will introducing the public space layer in our self-efficient neighborhood. First, what is public space? Public space is a social space or open, accessible by people. So we start doing research about the history of public space and the evolution. So it all started with the Acropolis in the Greek. It was centered by a temple, so it first was religious centered. Then it comes with the agora. Agora was like first built, and then the private houses, commercial markets are surrounded. And then we went to the Roman area. In Roman area, it's like a bigger polis, a volume, and it was surrounded by piazza, basilica, commercials. And in the 5th century to 15th century, in the long dark ages, it was like all condensed. And in the winding road of the winding street of the basics, the only existing public space was like a town center or church center. So it's in through all these type of public space, it's like not it's called public space by our sense, but it's not accessible by all public space. Like in Agora, only 1/7 of citizens are allowed to enter, like women, slaves are not. So, and come to modern ages, we had so many different type of public space, and it doesn't matter how like it's shaped, like from what Bryant Park, like 20,000 people visit every day, or Perry Park only. It's near a common residential, only few people visit it. It's about like the users, the people inside. I like to share a story. 2 years ago, I was doing research for Illinois Action in US. We had the Northern Champaign neighborhood. We had lots of empty lots, so we asked the neighborhood, what do you want to do with your lots? And they say, we're doing questionnaires. It was 80% response. They said, we want a new park. But actually, we already have 3 parks in the small neighborhood. Why do you still need parks? He said one park was like not feel safe. The other was filled with creepy teenagers, because the neighborhood was all kind of old people. So it's more about the users in the public space. Actually, in US, the highest percentage of public space city is Detroit, but we all know like what happened in Detroit. So this is the potential public space users, like a market seller, market goer, gardener, commuter, local artist, the public picnicker, busker, all kind of users, and how their desires and preference for public spaces. So in our self-efficient prototype, we want to create all the spaces that they kind of can use and they want to use. So the first strategy is to creating a different scenario for them, and also use strategy like a day share and a decentralized distributed. For example, we had the second hand, we had the night market, which is daily time pedestrian, but nightlife, but in the night it will be a food market. Here, we had 4 category. First, park nature. So for the permaculture park, regional park, it is distributed to, it is for the agriculture to grow our food. And we then had 5 neighborhood parks. It's 30,000 square meter, and 2 observation points created to for them to not observe the nature, but also urban scenario, and 29 urban gardens. The second scenario is events and leisure. For the several plazas, it's near the markets and and a religion center for the culture, and the culture event plazas are more like a permanent permanent uses, and for the art occasion, it's more like a temporary experimental for the urban of all architects, urban designers, art institute, like they can try something, experiment something in the area. And for the health support scenery, we had one football field, two dog parks, and during through our 25,000 people, we will need 4,000 square meter dog parks, but we make it two dog parks because our dense area do with the same square meters, so people can more communicate and interact in our place. Also for the fitness trail playground, it's like the adults and the children can use the equipment and doing the same time. Also next for the secondhand market, mobile food service, and urban camps distributed in our neighborhood. Next about the public lighting. Our public lighting will be equipment with Wi-Fi and the energy generated for them, so people can actually generate energy through our public lighting. And this is a Wi-Fi radius for the street lighting and public lighting fixtures. It covers, it's a municipal Wi-Fi, covers 90% our efficiency. And also we had our public space sensors, and it's totally possible to be true. Like we can connect their tweets and the people's uses, and the people can through that to actually analyze and choose like where they want to go. And if we say from the happy, unhappy generator wasn't like really high, we can find out what's about the public space. So next, Rahul will talk about more about the street grid and the mobility. Yeah.
Yeah, thank you.
I'll be talking about the layer of mobility. As we see, the cities are crowding, and we have like 90% of the total population growing in cities, 80% of global CO2, and 75% of global energy use is being used in cities. And we have consequences for that, like health and safety, environment, and buses, employment for most people. The direction is to the urban mobility is kind of promoting bicycle lanes, accessibility to public transport, expanding the area devoted to pedestrians, and decreasing in number of cars, which kind of creates less traffic in the road, and also including smart mobility along with the same system where we can get real-time information with where people can have integrated fare management between different mobility structures, and with creating a multimodal transportation, also kind of including bike and vehicle sharing. Also there has been a consistent change in the world right now happening. Like we can see, there has been a less number of car sales in more of the developed countries, like North America, which has in the last 10 years it has reduced from 42% to 27%. At the same time, the Western Europe has reduced from 33% to 19%. Also, there has been a significant increase in the number of bike share systems in the world. Like in 2001, there were only 4 cities which had bike sharing systems, and now we have like last year 855 of the systems have bike sharing system. So these are the 4 major comparisons what we did to understand the different modes of transport used per day. So we selected the different categories. Was like the person walking would in Barcelona it is 46%. In Berlin, the usage of car is 30%, which is the maximum. Copenhagen, the usage of bicycle, which is 30%, and in Curitiba, the public transportation, which is 45%. And accordingly, we kind of came up to this proposal where we will, for the prototype, we have 50% people will be going by walk. This because it has the same kind of intersections related to Barcelona. And then similarly, we kind of propose for 20% of bicycle and 20% of transportation and 10% of vehicles, which will not be a private cars, but shared cars. And these are the, when we start with the public transportation, what we see is the investment required for the different kind of transportation systems like bus, tram and metro. And it is the ratio is 1:10:100. And for us to become a self-sufficient, the bus was the most efficient and effective. So this is the frequent. This is the timeline of the Barcelona, where because of which we could kind of come down to a frequency of the bus journeys, which could take place throughout a day. And 6 to 9:11, we would have bus running at 2 minutes frequency, and the overall, after the calculating overall frequency, we will have like 540 buses will travel per each bus from each bus stop. This is the road network what we have, and we have like bus traveling in horizontal and vertical directions. And so we have created the nodes where the bus stops could come into place and where they could have a transit to change the buses. And after, the bus stops are located in such a way that from each bus stop, residents is less than 500, from commercial it is less than 350, and from facilities it is less than 250. And also creating a multimodal system where it is also including with the bicycle parking, which is less than 50 meters. And about the shared cars, like what we see in the world right now, the ratio of city residents, this is about the cars, the ratio of the city residents to car, and Amsterdam is kind of the lowest as compared to the other cities. And as we know, like the on an average, the car usage is only for 1 hour per day on an average. And thus, this also is a research where the IaaC group, which studied, they did a real case study about the shared cars plus using public transport, where they could kind of reduce the car by 10%. And then similarly, when they use it for peak times, they could reduce 35%. And throughout this, we could come to a conclusion where for a residence of 900, around 100 to 120 shared cars. This is where we kind of try to incorporate autonomous cars, and also the shared car systems will work somewhat like this, where we can call the autonomous car and it comes to pick you. You enter your destination and it dynamically routes you to your stops and tracking all the real-time data. And while the go, you can also have your personalized connectivity, and the car itself parks itself to the parking docks. This is kind of example which the Media Lab is working on. They have produced this car in collaboration with the Spanish company. This is the autonomous car, which kind of folds itself from to reduce the space in parking. As we see, from 100 inches, it goes on to become 6 inches. And also in the parking dock, where we can have like 3 conventional cars, it could house around 10 of these smart city cars. Also, it has provision where it can wirelessly transfer power. So, and the entrance from the can be opened from the near the parking so that it is more safety also. This is for the bicycles where we find like in London, we did a case search about London, Barcelona, where we find per 1,000 residents, the shared car system, shared bicycle. In London, it is 23 per 1,000 residents. In Barcelona, it is 9.2. So, but the ITDC has its own thing, like we can have 30-40 bicycles for every 1,000 residents. And similarly, we also understood the density, what we would require for the bicycle stations. It is around this thing is around 250 meters from each of the bicycle stations. This is also the technology what we can use to, this is the bike along with the green wheel where we can fold the handles to reduce the space for the storage, and also the green wheel can store energy and which can be used during the when the cycle is going uphill, and also the parking stations where one car can house, earlier it could house 8 bicycles, now by kind of inclining and providing inter stations we could kind of house 32 bicycles. And this is how the structure of the infrastructure develops. These are the burst lanes, and at the corners, at the nodes, we have bus stops where we can transfer the buses going horizontal, vertical. And these are the roads which develops, and we will have shared cars for shared car parking base in the 20 meter road. And we will have a vertical car parking for the neighboring cars coming into the prototype. This is the bicycle lane which connects all the different kinds of routes, the road network, and this is the section where again we have like most of the space is dedicated for the pedestrian, and also we have like different kind of layers of roads. Yeah, thank you.
Hello again. Now to end our presentation, I would like to show you how our networks and nodes work and relate to each other. And so we see that all of the layers work together towards these nodes, where is that the places where activity happens. We have an output of waste and an output of information that at the end is recycled. And okay, I would like to show you a video just so you can see how all the layers come together. Okay, so you've been seeing these general diagrams. Just to sum up, I want to say that, as you can see, after all our research, we found out that these specific configurations of infrastructure and of the physical environment can have a great impact on how we use our cities and how we relate to our environment, and that we can actually become a self-sufficient neighborhood. And wait. So this is the general plan, and later comes the configuration of the layers. So here we have this cell, which is the one we developed, and this is where it all comes together. Okay, so we have all the different layers that come together, and this is what we also reproduced in the model. We have energy, which with the different production ways, also food on the rooftops. Then we have the different household types, We have the facilities. Also here. And we also have another layer of tertiary functions that I didn't mention before, but we have offices and shops developing on the first floor, the public space which supports it, and also the infrastructure. And these are the water infrastructures. This is how it all comes together. And I would like to invite all my classmates to show you our final model. You can see the different colors here represented. We have colors for each layer, and so this is the self-sufficient prototype. Thank you so much.
So I am impressed. I am really very impressed. So let's, before to explain why I am impressed, let's give the floor to the jury to make the comments. I think just to say that I am impressed also for the presentation and for this idea of working as a team. This is something is really very difficult to do with the students. I like very much how you did the presentation and everything. So, but let's listen first the critics from the jury, that they have a very hard work because it has been like 1 hour and a half presentation. And after that, we'll make comments, okay?
Thank you, Vicente. And thanks for this invitation because he was impressed, but I was more impressed. I was telling Vicente, I was impressed by the quality of presentations. But also, you made it very quick, but understandable. Somehow, we are used in class having a slower presentations. This was a huge mass of information that you gave. Okay, I noticed that behind you have made an extraordinary work of statistics, evaluation, analysis, data setting, and also presentation of the results. So it was really incredible. How many months have you been working? 2.5. Okay, that's impressive. One of the considerations is that a group work made in this way with individual developments, is important, having a piece of knowledge and share the piece of knowledge as a whole. And this method, I do agree with this method. I'm using this method of sharing knowledge based on individual developments. But this structure that you are using is really effective. But now I enter certain comments. Food, I'm starting with certain, parts. Food, very good analysis. What about, and I don't need it to answer now, but think about and maybe the answers will come. Okay, it's you. Is that the principle of the future, is having a sort of ethical society in which everybody would be vegan? So in a way, this is not an answer you have to give, but there is a way in which we make analysis for having an efficient development plus certain or ethical or philosophical concept. Something is making it efficient, something is adding certain cultural, ethical topics. I make it simple. In energy, one thing is having efficiency, one thing is making sacrifice, one thing is having sufficiency. Is the sacrifice part of the design? It's something that I'm curious to know. What is the idea? I mean, in fact, there is efficiency in using the land in a certain way, maximizing the efficiency. On the other side, we have to look at the different implications of the different cultures. Concerning energy, you mentioned 1.52 square meters of PV, 3.4, etc. Very good. Based on what? So, of course, it was based on something. Of course, based on this climate, there is and not another climate. Based on certain level of presumed consumption. But what it means if I do not have consumption, I do need still 1.4252 square meters, or this is an average. When I'm saying, I mean, I put extremely huge insulation in the building, and I do not need just, I mean, I do not need anything in order to heat or in order to produce electricity. I have LEDs everywhere. I have the best fridge. Which are the parameters based on this? Because somehow you make them lower as much as possible, and so you do not need such a surface. Maybe. Or maybe you can answer already.
I have some other, also in a few minutes,
very good, of all the presentation, analysis and results. But do we have a full recycle and full production?
I've noticed that somewhere there were 22% of input of materials and 22% of output of wastes in the waste presentation. Is this the typical situation of the city, or based on which parameter? I noticed that there were 32 tons per day of waste, but this is a normal city, or is your city? Because 1 kilogram per person per day is a typical situation, or I'm wrong. So certain data I would like to enter more. But my main concern is the question on, you developed a very skilled, very relevant guidelines for a new model of city. Very in-depth. So now you can, in a way, give guidelines for a new model town. apart from certain points that I would like to share better and with you, what is the step forward? When you go in a real land, a real place, how you compromise? Because architecture is always a compromise, and you cannot do whatever the guidelines are there, but you cannot implement all the guidelines. So how you compromise and how you can make a synthesis of what are the guidelines into a real lot? Because when you enter the architecture and the volume and the quality and the space, is not numbers, is perception. And that step that we are used to do with our architecture students, is a very critical step in which sometimes we forgot the guidelines and we tend to use them, but we are not able to follow all the guidelines. So I like to know how you think in the future to adopt these very in-depth, very powerful guidelines that you developed. I mean, apart from these elements I was setting, I was really impressed by all your studies and elements. So congratulations again.
Okay, my congratulations from my side as well. I think there is an extremely interesting collective work being done here. It's not it's maybe easy to work layer per layer in the 7 or 8 layers that you have, but it's not easy to do what you have been doing here, like to overlap all those layers and figure out how one interconnects with the other and how one influences the other. So I am pretty amazed about this, and I am also pretty satisfied to see you all presenting on a very rigorous way, like all the analysis that you have been doing on the existing conditions, and also like how the impact of what you are proposing is happening for the new self-sufficient prototype. So I miss some kind of global data in a way, so I want to know which is the percentage of self-sufficiency in the new prototype that we have been, that you have been working on, no? Energetically, we know that, you know, how much is the percentage of self-sufficiency in Barcelona? Okay. Is it working?
Only one number. We want one number.
100%.
90%. Food. Yeah, local production. Yes, vegan. Vegan.
100% for housing.
Facilities, 100%.
Waste of zero, so 100%. Sufficient waste of zero water, yeah. Zero waste water, yeah.
Yeah. I think it's nine square per person, so it's sufficient in all the public space are workable.
Yeah.
For me, it's 0% zero waste, but as a neighborhood, there's 22% of production. But when a city comes together, I think it will go up to 85%.
Yeah, we don't have private cars. No private cars.
Okay. Yeah. No, that's great that you know the global impact of it. It would be nice that you, in a way, present it so that we have a global idea. In any case, apart from congratulating you, I was also thinking, knowing also many of the things that Vicente has in his head, I was thinking different things. So the first one is that I see here a kind of a city protocol, no? A kind of a protocol for a new self-sufficient neighborhood. And my question comes to the following topic. This is the anatomy of self-sufficient neighborhood. Is that correct? Then if we have the anatomy of a neighborhood, if we take the anatomy of a human body, then an athlete that is running, it has a bigger muscle on his foot. An athlete that is swimming, he has bigger like shoulders and stronger hands, no? So here is becoming too abstract for me, because what it would be interesting is to see how all those percentages that you are talking about and how all those analyses and proposals is becoming true in kind of a different case studies, no? Different case studies related with a topology, for example, a topography that is not 100% flat, related with a topography that it might have a river, related with a topography that might have mountains and shadows, and or related to climates that are very cold and maybe the photovoltaic panels are not enough, or maybe the geothermal energy should be bigger than the biomass or than the solar energy generation, et cetera, et cetera. So to me, the next step and the most interesting step is really how you take that into a real city body, no? Rather than a very abstract biological analysis of the anatomy. This is one point that I wanted to talk about. Then I was also asking Vicente while you were presenting, I was also thinking the fact that in a way I keep on seeing indeed new proposals for achieving self-sufficiency in different levels, but always talking with the same language that we have been talking until now, no? So energy generation through photovoltaic panels, through biomass, driverless cars, sharing cars, which are great, no? But to me, it would have been really interesting to start seeing first, what are the protocols that a designer of a city is putting on the table so that new things could start emerging? New activities could start emerging, no? About the public space I have been seeing, or the facilities, the typical ones, no? Sports, religion, and then the active the public space, park, plaza, you know? But that is not true even now. I'm not saying that you need to be like 20 years ahead. We are already in a kind of a different way of how we inhabit our public space, no? Information technologies, for example, is one thing that has is forcing us or is helping us or is contributing to navigate the city in a different way, to inhabit the public space in a different way. So in a way, I think that new spaces should start emerging. New facilities are something that we need to think about, the same way that you are thinking of the Fab Labs as a new facility for the city that was not there 10 years ago. I am sure that there are more new emerging programs, facilities, and other topics related to the urban scale that I've seen nobody talking about this. And last but not least, I think that when you start to introduce those kind of new protocols, I am pretty surprised to see a very traditional blocking building block going around, no, in terms of the form of the building. And I'm saying that not so that we can have something more organic or something more parametric. I'm saying that, for example, let's take the issue of the waste and the issue of the housing. No? Where is the waste treatment happening? Is it always happening in a central square, in a central building? Can we start combining the building of the housing the same way that those beautiful sections of mixing programs? Can we start also thinking that the infrastructure, the facilities are part of those buildings? And if that is the case, then what does this mean for the new anatomy of a building, no? What does it mean for the new architecture and the new design of the building? And with that, I think I've said my.
Well, first of all, as we all say, congratulations. I mean, it's been a very nice talk. As like the way you concentrate all the talks, that's been amazing. Like you are usually not standing a presentation which lasts for 1.5 hours and has so many inputs and everything, right, that smoothly. So congratulations on that. Then about my points, I don't think I'm going to point and imagine one you did. What I'm going to say, it's more towards the future, this next month happening. Of course, I guess Vicente and all the team has many ideas on how to follow. But in my opinion, something really important to start thinking now, it's the idea of resiliency. And why I'm talking about this, because at the end, you need to design strategies to support change. No? One of the bigger issues that we have nowadays is that in the way we design many systems, cities also, they are not efficient in the way they tolerate change. The way we are tolerating change nowadays basically is by feeding mostly cheap energy. If you feed cheap energy to a system, you can change it as much as you want, but we know the consequences of using cheap energy. We know that this will lead to an end. So designing the strategies to tolerate change is really important. And you took one as a starting point, which is really important, is decentralizing systems. Of course, we all know that decentralized systems, they tend to be more resilient. But at the same time, always, if you think on distributed systems, they always have on top of them another strategy, because distributing is not enough. So if you think on nature, we come out with natural evolution, natural selection. If you think on the internet, there's something called packet switching and end-to-end topologies. That's how the internet still works after 30 years. So there's so much strategy you need to take there. And I think the way to analyze this in the future is that you are mostly thinking on a two-dimensional system, right? And maybe three-dimensional somehow. So the idea is to add a fourth dimension, which is time. You have to start thinking on timelines and simulations. They need to add time. So you need to be able to think on those models, not if they suddenly come out as they are, how they will evolve. How they will evolve, of course, thinking on there's some randomness there. There's things that don't happen that we cannot predict. There are things that we can predict, and maybe some technological changes that they are not, cannot be implemented right now, but they can be implemented. There are things that we won't need. So, of course, we need to start treating this as a system that evolves and start feeding all this randomness and all these consequences that could happen and see how it evolves. So mostly what I'm saying is that, okay, let's get all these diagrams that we did and let's add another dimension on them. Let's frame it. Let's imagine that we can stack those one on top of the others and think how they evolve on time. Mostly, I think, towards also adding something which this is really linked to what I already say, which is also how do we put more emphasis in how do we involve the people who live on that cities, no? Let's imagine that many of the way this is going to be operating at the end, I guess based on many of your ideas, you will agree, is on the idea that there's co-creation by citizens. There's, of course, policies they can change quickly and adapt on how the city is operating. So to do that, we need to simulate, we need to test how these things can work based on this complex situation. So basically, my conclusion will be, let's see how we add this dimension, how we see the simulations on a timeline. So that's all. Thank you.
Okay, well, also from my side, congratulations. I found that was a very concise and very interesting presentation. You've taken a very complex problem and basically deconstructed that into digestible and easily understood parts. Having worked with and alongside UN Habitat and UNESCO, I've seen presentations along these lines for the past 10 years, and I would say that this is one of the clearest urban scale responses that I've seen and heard, so congratulations on that. The UN terms for this, they call it the global problematique. And you know that whenever we start using French words, it's difficult stuff. So I think when we're looking at the global problematique and trying to have an urban scale and local response, I think that it's an important thing to be able to understand all of those layers, but it's an even more important thing to be able to connect them. So Guillaume started to talk about energy, but also time. Everything is divided by time. And also matter, energy, and time are relative. We've known that for a while. So what are those connections? What are those hidden connections? And what are those aspects that we can explore to make a resilient network? And the network is, by definition, connected. So what are those aspects? This is an economic problem. So we have an economics of distribution. That is the mode of economics that you have chosen to deliver as your response, your urban response to that global problematic. Now, I also agree with Areti in some ways that you're using the same rhetoric. I can hear the terms that you're using, and they're not new. I would be interested to see, although your conjugation of those terms was very, very concise and well delivered, the same terms you are still using. So how can we then, especially in this place, in IaaC, together with the Fab Labs, how can we look forward to an advanced terminology and start to look at new iterations of the same response? So in that way, I would like to list some of those aspects that I've felt inspired by you to talk about. Metabolism. This is the conversion of matter and energy. Metabolism's a great term. It's a biotic term. But there's more than that. We could also talk about catabolism or antabolism. Catabolism being the conversion of energy into matter, and antabolism being the conversion of matter into energy. So these sorts of terms can be applied across the board, translating directly from energy to matter in a real sense. So these are terms that you could start to pick up on and use. They're also quantifiable in biology. So if you look at the science of biology, you might be able to use some of those equations to help you analyze what would actually be self-sufficient. I work in the Green Fab Lab in Canvaidaura, which is a very large area of green. It could be called the gray lab, the brown lab, the pink lab, whatever you like. There's a lot of colors in the ecology up there. But permaculture, food, okay. So permaculture is a term which is being used. I prefer to use the term agroecology. Permaculture is understood, and for that reason it's a good term to use. But agroecology allows in science, it allows in Japanese traditions like Masanobu Fukuoka, who is not a permaculturist but invented it. He didn't invent it. This has been going on for 10 years. So agroecology as a term, I think, encapsulates science, but also just to understand what permaculture really is, it means permanent agriculture. So that means a constantly situated growing environment. But it also doesn't exclude animal life. In the food forest, the permaculture food forest that we have in Vaidaura, the wild boars, the squirrels, the birds, they all play a role in that. The chickens are the best composting device that we have. They're amazing. And they taste quite good as well, you know. So I don't think you need to exclude that. Yeah. So then we have to be innovative. Yeah. Anyway, you want to have some inputs and some outputs and be able to control that. But that's your design. And also permaculture is a design system that you could change and use. Just two more terms. The commons. When we're talking about a distributed or a network and this high density that we're searching for. I've heard people talk about Manhattan being the most sustainable place on Earth because it's so highly densely populated. And with that high density, the propensity to share and the necessity to share and have public resources could be privately shared or autonomously shared, it doesn't matter politically, but with those shared resources, you have something called the commons, the common access to that library, that material library, that food library, if you will. So then we have terms of the tragedy of the commons and the overuse of those public services. So it's very interesting for me, and this leads to the next point, of having systems of management. So e-services, I think, is something extremely important. And then using data and using intelligent data, turning data into information, is relevant. Smart city. Yeah? City and technology. There we go. There you go. So finally, I think there's two things that I really want to go forward into this with. And one is future technologies. People are looking at biology as the salvation, saving discipline of the sciences. Previously, it was physics and chemistry. Okay, let's look to that. That's real science. Biology, no, that looks at animals and categorizes them. No, biology has changed. So embrace those changes. And resilience, as Guillaume was saying, is about embracing change also. So look to biology, look to synthetic biology. What does that mean to go beyond a greenhouse on the roof and actually be able to grow wheat there, you know, in a way that would be profitable? Finally, what does that mean for how local? How local can you get? Can you have a power station in your house? Can you have a fabrication laboratory next to your kitchen? Is it possible that the entirety of your water and your waste can be metabolized within your house? You know, these are targets. That's something that I think as designers, architects, engineers, technologists, makers, that's the things that we should strive for. And that's where diversity is really born, at the housing or the extreme local scale. But also when you were, finally, just to say, and to go back to physics, when you say 100% self-sufficient, I don't believe you. I don't, because you're always connected to the sun. You can't be 100% self-sufficient. And if you are saying 100% self-sufficient, you need to encapsulate that in social or urban terms only, because you cannot be 100% self-sufficient. If you cut yourself off from energy, you are disconnecting. So it's the connections again, also to the sun, that makes these things self-sufficient. And that's why I think the term, the Spanish term, is better than the English for this, rather than the self, which is just me or just this. I prefer the autosuficiencia, self-running. You know, it can operate by itself, not for itself. But anyway, thank you very much. It was really informative.
I'm just going to say something very short and sweet. First of all, my most sincere congratulations. The work and the quality of the research is amazing. So I'm very proud of all of you. I just had a couple of questions that have already been mentioned. I think my main doubt as to, or something that I would have liked you to talk about in presenting this self-sufficient neighborhood prototype, is also related to how does the economy of this self-sufficient neighborhood work? And I think that becomes very important because when you start producing your own food, your own energy, who owns it really? And who's paying for the distribution infrastructure and stuff like that? And who's making all of this kind of stuff work? And related in a way to that, what kind of societal structure do I need to really make this kind of self-sufficient neighborhood function? I mean, what kind of policies, rules and regulations do I need to apply? And I also have a question or a doubt related to, and I understand this is like a protocol or a prototype, but different cultures around the world react very differently. We've just been to China, and in any case, very differently to different ways of living. So I find it very difficult to imagine a sort of a canonical strategy, let's say. How could this adapt to different necessities? Not only, and I'm not only talking about, okay, if this is located in a tropical location or something, I'm talking about the people who have to live the city, the main protagonists. This being said, I'm really excited about your proposal, and I was interested to know whether you had also, I mean, I guess you've in some way been working on the basis of this case study of Barcelona. Did you in some way think about how you could start actuating this sort of self-sufficient prototype in Barcelona, how you could start sort of injecting this parasite self-sufficiency into the city, and very important and linked to this, and we've already discussed it in other courses, what kind of education does the society need to go through to be able to get to actually living in a self-sufficient neighborhood? But congratulations.
Congratulations for your work. I think it's very interesting. You are like an open a new way to understand the Ibram protocol, or continuing this idea of Ibram protocol, make a good book. Make a good book to share this information with other people around the world. I'm totally agree with Areti in this idea of envision, no? To have an envision of the city, and parallel to the design, this is for teachers, I don't know, it's not for you, but this, to have this envision, at the same time you are working with the number. It's not the protocol that hold all the ideas that after you develop are like based in the ideas of now or for 20 years. Well, more or less well known. This is the other is to be with a new Chomsky, Noam Chomsky, it's Jonathan, the new Noam Chomsky. That is so good. It's mixing it with French, Spanish, English. It's, it's nice. And in this, but it's very important that this is in the semantic or the meaning of the word, no? How the meaning of the word changes the possibility, you know. When you say that of this idea of self-sufficient, autosufficiency, etc., I remember this moment in the film of how much weight you're building, Mr. Foster, no? That's in the with Fuller in the helicopter. I say, and you can say, how much is your city self-sufficient, Mrs. Guallart? No. and it's very interesting this idea of grays, no, to have between white and black, to have these different grays or level, and to go forward in your protocol, I miss something very important in this design. What is this? Is the underground. There are nothing about underground. There are nothing about topography. Just when you we look at this picture that we saw, is a surface very perfect. That in other way is in the tradition of the utopic city of the world. But the value of the earth, the value of the death, and the inverse city. Is very powerful. It's very powerful because if you make a hole in Barcelona, a hole of 1 meter, 2 meters, 3 meters, you have the city that you have. There are other cities totally different. And this city is the part are infrastructure, but other one are spaces. For example, in Seoul, I think the 25% of the space, public space, are underground. Are discos, bar, restaurant, etc. Are 1, 2, 3, 4 floors underground. No, they're like other city. Maybe this model for the next jury need to have like a transparent thing that they show the thing that are like in the underground. And for somebody, it's very useful to work with waste, to exchange energy, to use as a filter for water. To have a tank water or this like Barcelona half, no, it's amazing visit that you can do with your teacher, no, to see this big dam there in the underground, no, to understand the scale of the this infrastructure in this. And a suggestion is to have a in the top of a ground is this book of Adele Bobo, Made in Tokyo. No? Made in Tokyo. If you read Made in Tokyo with humor, like with an open mind, that you see is this complexity of the hybrid buildings and the overlapping mixed use with other. The other way, no? Another way, you have a roller, big roller coast over a bus parking. It's something more than a block and a block. There are something that they have a interlace, a structure, energy, life, time, etc. In other way that we see here inside of the Tente, no? Or the Lego. Price that are like more like MRDV that have all different spaces overlapping with the same taste. No? I know it's a diagram and you know it's in process, but this to see other reference that could be linked more with this idea of design with ambition that I already said before.
Professor Rubio.
Oh, yeah. Yeah. There is something, well, first congratulations because there is something we architects tend to do or we used to do, and is that we used to think that architecture was to design buildings, or we used to think that designers used to think that designing a bottle is to design a bottle, to draw the shape, the section, the plan, very advanced designers used to think how to fabricate this bottle, for example. Kind of advanced architects used to think if the building can produce energy or if the building behaves properly in terms of thermal inertia, but that's it. But what we were seeing here is that we can go back in the steps of production of this building from the very first moment when you extract a piece of clay from the ground, no? So, and we saw the complete process of the flow of matter. The same with every layer of the ones that you did. And I think this is very radical for like a node to change how architects think their architecture. So designing is should be no longer about just drawing how the object should be or is going to be, but designing should be give instructions to describe the process, the complete process of extraction of the materials, behavior of the society that is using these resources. That's why if design has changed so much, if it's not just about describing objects. If design is something like saying we should be vegetarian, and I agree this is design, and then this should be design, then we architects have to change completely our tools and our way of thinking. That's why a lot of the discussion that has taken place here was questioning the degree of abstraction that the spread had. And I think this is a very important point to discuss. So, because architects, we were used to speak about concrete things or specific objects. We are not so used to speak about only numbers or about only abstract relationships or about only behaviors of the society, just behaviors or ethical rules, or and we lack architecture lacks the tools to speak about all these things as a proper science. And I think most of the kind of difficulties in apprehend this project are originated there. And I think this is something we have to fight for or expand our tools in this direction, no? So that we can talk about abstract ideas, talk about protocols, talk about systems, even before speaking about the project, and being able to share our protocols with other architects with the same self-security or the same self-security as before architects were speaking out specific objects. Like Javier was talking about this, the hybrid that appears in Tokyo. So all these hybrids are super well explained because they are specific projects. They are objects that exist. They have this concreteness. So we need to speak out our abstractionness with the same kind of detail and science.
Received. Alex, any comment?
Thank you. How we can keep space for humans to personalize this space, no? How we can don't become a huge machine where you get lost into it. But I think it was not the topic of the class. I don't think it was the topic of this project. It was exactly the opposite, to go to the abstraction. And the next task will be how do we apply it and humanize it and make it like that people can do it, maybe with technology, maybe with all these applications, we attach these phones and things like this, but how we get connected to the city and it's not something that operates distant from us.
Okay, after a debate, and now you have already all the congratulations, so be quiet because it was effective. But thinking the challenge of the future, you did something that we normally do not do with our classes because it's, I mean, we would like to make this. But at the end, is the state of the art. It's an excellent state of the art. It was mentioned, I mean, what is the challenge in future? And you, since are in the advanced planning, advanced architecture, you should look at the challenges of future. Was mentioned, going to the land is a challenge of any excellent guidelines. You have the innovation, technology innovation, and the social innovation. The technology innovation is more and more linked to the nature that can dominate technology. And was mentioned, the biomimicry, all the biology applied to the innovation is something that is the future. Is the future of the technologies also for the new cities. So bring in this challenge of specifying, especially in the materials topics, more than the current material, the what can be done in future, in the future model town. On the other side, the social innovation, we have a lot to do instead of splitting numbers of two couples, three persons, five persons, five bedrooms, etc. We are going to have some change in future. Telecommunication and smart cities are mixing the levels of living and working. Somehow is everything is more compact, and these situations are influencing the new pattern of the city and also the mobility and what's said. Then, so looking at the technology innovation in which you are here more or less, and the social innovation or inclusion is something that you should look at also when you land in the area. And thinking that the land is full of constraints, when she was saying there might be a river, there might be anything, and the level of architecture there is mixing, is taking into account the parameters, but then is influenced by the view, is influenced by
all the other aspects of architecture and by the preeminence of some parts compared to other, some parameters compared to other, and this is something, the compromise of architecture. You will be full of compromises at the end, and you have to forget about something in for taking into account something else.
Okay, so now one round of students' comments, answers, like 1-2 minutes maximum.
Thank you. For example, I use average consumption of Barcelona per household, per industry, agriculture. But for example, for houses, I use not old houses energy consumption. I put new and isolated houses energy consumption. So, thank you. Yes. Yes. And I use all of them, all data, all inputs are for new technologies consumption, not old one. Because yeah, I also use that inputs, but I think try to be self-sufficient with today's technology and today's inputs is also a big challenge. So that's why we decided to use today's most efficient inputs. I can also say 50 years later, houses consume less than today's, and I can also put this small number. But we try to be realistic. We try to be like a mathematics. So that's why I use these numbers.
Okay, first, thank you for all your comments. I hope to address some of the questions that you made. About what Rodrigo was saying, a bit of how we were abstract, I think this was, at first, it was a bit of a challenge for us to like get away from the specific stuff and start working on something that can be general and doesn't have a direct connection to something real. This was a bit challenging, but now we can realize that these protocols that we have at the end can be implemented in many cities because of the same reason of being abstract. Also, like this led us to, we did have into consideration the people, but it's also very difficult to think about how a society works here because also it was abstract, but we can say that after putting all these networks in different use, society is also very much connected to how you use the everyday infrastructure, like how it connects to your daily life. So if you have all your food grown in your own cell, well, in your own neighborhood, well, this changes how you move and how you relate to other, to the rest of the city. If we could develop further the project, of course we would address more real cases, but I think this would serve as a guideline to act on this. And of course, when you have a real city, you have to take into account the cultural background, the cultural behaviors, but I think we're lucky and like we have a very diverse group, and that also like it was a constant exchange of ideas also from cultures and from other places where we've lived. So that also helped in the development of this.
Thank you. I would like first to answer about the permaculture. When I said, maybe it's my fault, I wasn't clear. When I said we don't want animals, I meant for farming. But because if we do have chickens, which is the case because it will help in the system of permaculture, we don't want them for eating purposes. It's not This is not, because even if we do want to raise them, we won't have enough space for to feed 25,000 people. This is why I said we exclude this part. But and also concerning vegans, I asked myself the same question, and I asked him and Ruxandra and Alessio and Vicente, that it seemed really weird that we took 25,000 vegans all of a sudden. But then but then when we when I really researched about it, even myself was affected by it, because when you think about the fact that one portion can change, one portion per week can change a lot about the environment, which is a problem that is being addressed more and more. Like, I've done a lot of research about this. I am actually reducing a lot my meat. This is all their fault, really. You can ask them what I had for lunch today. But the thing is that there are so many technological answers for vegetables and fruits and beans, etc. But there are no answers yet for meat, except lab-grown meat that we found out about, but it's not really, it's weird. So I think that at some point, we all have to be aware about this problem, that it's creating 48% of our air pollution. So at some point, if we really want to keep producing enough food for everyone, because the population keeps growing, we have to be aware of the fact that, okay, if I at least reduce my meat consumption, it'll be better for my environment. So.
Based on her answer and your answer, there is a difference. She was placing the target at a certain normal level, current level. You put the target at a very high level in terms of social innovation, say, or whatever, use. So why not having the same target for the first basic assumption, and then you increase in all areas?
Well, this is true. We had a debate. We decided that we don't want animal cruelty. So she was developing the constitution for these cities, that in fact you present, we make a constitution for sure, because there are some basic rules, no private cars, then this, no animal cruelty, and this is the consequence of this. But my perception is I like meat, and I like also the rural production of meat. That's a question. But here we don't like animal cruelty.
Thank you for all the comments. One thing that I, in the beginning of the studio, I always ask my question, like, how are we going to be self-sufficient? How is that going to work? But I think seeing all the people working at different layers, and now we have the sensibility and general knowledge and fundamentals of like how the different systems and can be self-sufficient in the city. We all kind of gain from this, because we all come from architectural background, and as a student of master and senior technology, now we know like the systems of the city, how they can work together. I think it was like a good collective learning experience for all of us. And I agree with the comment of the perception of time in our neighborhood, and I think that will be the next step, actually, thinking another layer. Thank you.
Hi. For the question of the traditional approach to facilities or to design of the grid, or I think that this is the first step, the first idea, so it's very abstract, is not for the future, but is for now, with the actual use of the city. And facility are very related to society. We don't have a society. So we take the typical facility that are all over the typical uses of the cities. The challenge was to combine every layer, to make that every layer work perfectly with other layer. So next step will be like thinking in the future, thinking in the people who live in the social aspect, and in the time for sure. So all of this.
Yeah, and for water, being self-sufficient, it's like about also your comment. I never say we are self-sufficient for water because we have to have a network of fresh water from outside. But in case of water, the thing is not wasting what we have, what we take from outside. So for this case, for instance, we consume much more water than Barcelona because we have our agriculture. So it's not about the number that we take from outside, but it's about the system that we make it really efficient or like working like a machine. And the challenge of water is I had to start from crops because like I cannot take per capita water using anywhere because we have a different system here. Also for new facilities, what is the industry of ours? What is the industrial consumption of ours? What is the consumption of fab labs or future fab labs? And it's a challenge, but I tried to combine different ideas, like for instance how we're going to share our living areas and washing machines and how much we're going to use in this new system. Every little details change really big numbers, so yeah, it's a really complex process.
Yeah, about public space, you will
affects the yeah exactly. Exactly, yeah.
About public space, I think like I got many inspiration today, but about the public space, why it's so traditional. Maybe one, I know the information platform, maybe the new public space, the public space is like the classics, like even virtual reality become reality one day. We still need public space, like 2000 years ago, Socrates and Plato was talking in the Acropolis, they were discussing things. It's like the things like never change. Like you can like talking in Twitter, but you still need to hang out with your students. A social space like classics, like not example. Like I can say like 2000 years later, we are still need the tradition public space layout. Yeah.
Thank you for all your comments. About the numbers, I've fallen a few numbers for the standards of waste and material consumption, but as you said, the outcome, like the either recycled materials, recycled products, will change eventually the material consumption. Also, we are talking about locally fabricating. So this is more about the policy level decisions where we introduce these fabrication centers in the city as a part of school, universities to promote making locally or making for yourself. And eventually, I think the number of consumption will be becoming less, and hence the material that we are recycling and entering in back to the city proportion wise will be more. So I think it will, as you said, because over the time I have to categorize it maybe and work with the numbers. Thank you.
Yeah, for me, like working on the layer of mobility initially, when we said like we don't have any private cars, it was kind of very abstract for me, like initially. But throughout the process, I kind of learned how there are things happening, changing in the world right now. And we are kind of going towards a no private vehicle kind of thing, a phenomenon of that thing. Yeah.
Okay, so maybe one last comment. Again, thank you again to the students and the jury member. Thank you to the people that is looking to us in internet. We'll check how many people were looking to us. But we like very much to be open, to be connected, etc. So, you know, some time ago when I was in Baidaura one Saturday morning with some students, and we were working with some bricks, we're cleaning the bricks, and I discovered, I learned something very, very important that is very basic. That is, when you have a brick, and you clean a brick and you save a brick, what you are doing is not only saving the brick, but you are saving also the energy that is inside the brick. So you need to use more energy in order to make another brick. So again, this was part of my experience. I always follow the Socratic approach, that the best knowledge is the one that you learn through your own experience. And then what I say this sample, because in this model, in this project, that obviously now you will produce a booklet, we'll be able to share. We always say that we need three generations of students. So next year we'll try to do this again, but the student will be coming, will be working on top of what you did, and that's why we produce, that's how we produce the city anatomy and many other things, because it's this kind of knowledge that we have. I think that maybe the most, let's say, simple thing that I learned when we had been working on this is the idea, one day we were talking about the economy, no, about who is paying that, what happened with the infrastructure, what happened with the water and things like this. And something that I learned that I think is really very powerful is this idea that imagine that we make this neighborhood somewhere in the desert or somewhere, and some people is paying for it. And then the people that is paying to buy, to rent or whatever, somehow they own the infrastructure. And then at some moment, then imagine that the citizens are owners of this. Because this will be another discussion. Imagine that we have a solar plant outside. So from that point of view, this is, let's say, green production of energy, but the people are not directly connected with the production. So in that case, what we are doing really is empowering the people, because they are producing the energy, they are producing the food. Obviously, it's not them, but it's the community that is doing this. So from that point of view, at that point, then what we can imagine is that some of the problems or the questions that we are looking today in the world, that is about who owns things, if the government owns the thing, if the government can sell the infrastructure. This is what is happening in Greece, or what has been happening in Spain, that when there is a crisis and then somehow the citizen, we decide that the government is ruling our country or our city for us, and then in some moment there is a crisis and we lose the control because the government did something or because corruption or something like this. So in a city like this, this should be impossible. So that means that the property of the infrastructure should always remain property of the people, you know. And then obviously we call this public, but the question is that is not owned by the government, is that is owned by the people, that in your house, by paying your house, you are paying the infrastructure and you are paying the shares that you are paying in order to fabricate your shoes, to 3D print your shoes, your, let's say, produce food. And obviously we like that there is innovation, there is private property, we like, let's say, this sharing, whatever. But what is fundamental is that by developing self-sufficient cities, we try to give back the power to the people to control their own lives. And this is something that obviously this is revolutionary, because is connecting, if our friend Alexei Novikov was here, he would say, well, I am a Russian anarchist. We are not anarchists in the traditional sense that we say to the anarchists that we don't like the government and we want whatever. We like the self-organization of the people. And in the traditional sense, this is what the cities were about putting together resources in order to be able to produce things together. And then we need to invent. We deal with the invention of the word self-sufficient or autosuficiente, as Jonathan say. We need to invent a new word for the politics of this city, because it's about new forms of economy that is not to be anarchist, to be against everything, but this to be pro-everything, to be pro-collaboration, to be pro-sharing, to be pro protective against the people that want to destroy this, that want somehow to get more benefits, that want to use the city for their own profit. So we have the challenge, maybe for next generations, is to discuss what is the name of the government behind of this, what is the name for the economy behind of this, because what is very clear, Areti was right, you are not futurists, you don't fly cars, you don't, yeah, it's true, but all of this will happen. We wanted to be absolutely radical to answer a very simple question. How much energy we can produce in 1 kilometer by 1 kilometer for 25,000 people? How much food can we produce? And I think that your answer were amazing. You really get the answer. You were very realistic. We'll talk with you in Habitat and we'll say, you know, those are the new standards. Why are you making cities that are not producing all the energy you can do? Maybe the investment here will be 10, 15% more. Is something about this, is not double of the price, because you see it's a normal city, it's a feasible. The only thing that you need to decide is that obviously you want to do, you want to live in a place like this where you have the control of your own life. No? So again, yeah, this is the tradition of IaaC, working together in order to make projects, learning from each other, and then trying to build something on top of it. So your name will be now registered in the history of IaaC as the first student that were working in the self-sufficient neighborhood and city prototype. I want to thank to Areti as academic director for the Institute, and also Rodrigo that was doing this kind of dark work that in general in IaaC is always someone doing, that is making, integrating, doing the work, drawing, trying to produce the model. Yeah, Ruxandra and Alessio were absolutely part of it, again, part of the dark work. But at the end, I am happy that you really, Roberto today was saying, but do you have 35 nationalities in 80 students? And I said, yes, it's part of our tradition too. So that means that if one Chinese girl is talking about public space, or you will be making a revolution in China, or you will not be accepted as Chinese. If someone from India is doing the right public infrastructure about transportation with no traffic jam, you will be doing a revolution, and you will be exposed from your country. If you are becoming vegetarian or doing all the energy in Turkey, it will be again not accepted. So I hope that you will be accepted in your country when you are back, and you will be the revolution together. So thank you.